Imagine an infinite hex map. You stand in one hex with the rest of your party. Next to you is the statue of a long forgotten king, overgrown with weeds. The inscription on the statue is not in your common tongue. There is nothing else but gray desert sands, wide and still in all directions. You decide to travel, but it will take a full day to get to the next hex. This is how the fourth installment of Anti-Sisyphus, a tabletop role-playing game zine, starts. Lost in an infinite desert with no inherent purpose, no meaning, no goal. But then you start to play. Going from one hex to the next takes an entire day. This place is huge. God, you might be here for months. But time is passing, visibly. Sunrise and sunfall. What does that look like? You think about this alone in the desert. Maybe it springs to mind as you narrate the opening of the adventure. The text doesn't help you, so your mind pours images of Tatooine into your head, the legendary twin sons. But that only brings out more questions, so maybe there is no sun. But that too raises even more questions. Questions the text continues to not answer. This may confuse you, but in the end, there really is no wrong answer. Delight in what they create, and the knowledge that neither of us had any part in its creation.
Dangerous, sir.
I know. I'll be okay.
It was the spring of 2017 when I first discovered the mythology of Anti-Sisyphus. New York City. An unorthodox spring break. My roommate, Ludwig, and I found ourselves at a museum. And I found myself standing before something sublime. In the truest sense of the word. Taller than me, wider than me, and deeper than anything I had ever seen. I felt myself swallowed by it, unable to look away. Entangled within the layered splatter, drips, and flings of paint, there was this pulsing energy, much like you find within the infinite desert of this hex map.
I can control the flow of the paint. There is no accident, just as there is no beginning and no end. Sometimes I lose a painting, but I have no fear of changes, of destroying the image, because a painting has a life of its own. I try to let it live.
Jackson Pollock helped pioneer the method of painting known as action painting, where instead of working from sketches or drawings, he would stand over his outstretched canvas to make himself closer physically to the work, and therefore emotionally. And, I quote, "Here, the direct application of an automatic approach to the act makes it clear that not only is this not the old craft of painting, but it is perhaps bordering on ritual itself, which happens to use paint as one of its materials. And this way we can see that the hex crawl, this infinite desert, this tabletop role-playing game, it too is a ritual, one that uses dice and absence to give this space a life of its own. You've finally crossed into the next hex. What do you see? In all directions, the gray sands stretch to the horizon. There is nothing else. This happens 98 out of 100 times. Absolutely nothing. The pure absence of a thing. Negative space, a blank canvas. I know when I first read this, my head spilled paint across the canvas as I imagined that each edge of the hex on this map was well defined in the world, a small crack in the ground that revealed the shape of this hex and descended infinitely down. There are things. Terrible, awful things, Anti-Sisyphus says, that we as yet must suffer if we intend to tell table stories. It's not only that, but also the things that are most often interesting about a tabletop role-playing game are the things that aren't written within the text at all. The important questions that must be answered without guidance. Empty spaces, that negative space, that gets filled with meaning simply for existing. It reminds me of the first time I played Minecraft. Of course, as the sun set, zombies and skeletons and spiders spawned in the dark splotches around me and began to threaten my very short existence, and I didn't want to die, so I built a shelter. The game never necessarily told me to do that, but I did it. And in the morning, I walked until I found a cave. I dug up some coal, made some torches, and I spelunked into that cave, going deeper and deeper, watching it twist and turn and even fall out from under me in spots, placing torches until there were no more left. Not being able to see any further, I started to panic. But I dug up, placing blocks beneath me just as soon as I was digging them out from above me, creating this 2-block-high elevator of stone and gravel, slowly moving me up from the depths, closer to the surface. Eventually, I hit something that wasn't gravel or stone. It was sand, and I, at that point, had no idea what was coming. But soon enough, I found myself punching into the ocean, flooding my small space and sending me even further into my panic. Quickly, I swam towards the surface, but I found myself trapped beneath the water. Ice blocked my way. The bubbles above my health bar were popping one by one, and I knew that death would soon come. I had so much iron, so much unsmelted ore. I had no idea where I was. Death was the worst outcome for me. Never being able to return to this spot, wasting all of that time just to go back to the spawn. Furiously, I punched the ice from below with weakened strikes. Even as I started to die, my health draining, I continued to punch through that glitching, drowning animation. And just as it looked dire, I broke through and caught my first gasp of air. I survived. The game didn't script this to happen for me. The ice wasn't placed there for me. The game itself was not paying any attention to me. It just simply was. In Anti-Sisyphus 3, Jared Sinclair, the writer, details the creation of a dungeon. I think that I'd like to make one perfect dungeon and fill it with all the things that don't belong in our world. Now, the typical way that dungeons are created in the context of tabletop role-playing games is that there's a map. You can really pick any map, or you draw your own. Just a couple squares on a piece of paper is good enough. Then each of those rooms is numbered or labeled in some way, and there's a key that goes along with those numbers. Each room being described in detail, sometimes less detail, sometimes way more detail than is truly necessary. Then, with all of this done, it is put together and packaged and sent out into the world with hopefully enough information that somebody else can run it, that they can translate that information and run it for the people at their table. Anti-Sisyphus does none of this. Instead, what it does is invite us into the idea of this particular dungeon. It could call out from across the world to yours, which you have filled with your own horrors as I have with mine. And we can listen to our dungeons and the dreams they have together, knowing that we have no power to help them because they are perfect already. It's said that the term dungeon master, commonly used in Dungeons and Dragons, came from the fact that each person, each dungeon master, had a dungeon, just one, and they would run it for their friends and let them explore, probe the depths, look for treasure, slay monsters, gather up all the resources and general fun they could. And when they would reach the end, the dungeon master would take it away and add on more. There would never be an end. They would always add another floor or a secret door or some new mystical means to reach this core. Anti-Sisyphus strips away this facade and says it out loud. Hey, journey into me. Explore my depths. This is my cave system. This is me. And not only that, but it asks you to participate in the ritual yourself, to imagine your own dungeon, to look into it and see it full of the terrible things that we gave it. Zeus loved his punishments. I still remember this scene from God of War, which shows Prometheus and his lovely, lovely eternal punishment.
God of War, you live! I no longer walk with the gods. Who has placed you in this torment? Zeus!
Sisyphus suffered a punishment of a different kind, cursed to roll a boulder up a steep hill, only for it to slip from his grasp and roll back down to the bottom before ever reaching the top. His task is an endless and monotonous one. The mythology of Antisys, then, must be a rejection of this punishment. The boulder is there, and it will always be there, but why not just climb to the top of the hill without it? Again, there are things, terrible, awful things that we must yet suffer if we intend to tell table stories. And in the first two issues, Anti-Sisyphus tries instead to give us smaller boulders as a way to fight against these awful things. A weather system that is intuitive and easy, skills that don't need too much explaining behind them, rules for keeping track of light sources, little tidbits of system that point to meaning only in as much as they don't state a meaning explicitly. For if there is a system for light, there is a meaning hidden in the dark. I am well aware that the task of connection falls ultimately to you, dear reader. After all, I'm not there at your table, as attractive a prospect that may be. It's the game developer. The implied meaning of a text, of a gaming text, when a game asks you to push the boulder up the hill, Anti-Sisyphus is there to kill them. Let the designer die, Anti-Sisyphus says. Let them die. But then what improvement is this? It asks. What good could my death, the death of a game designer, possibly do you, dear reader? Augustine said, love God and do what you will. I say to you, know that I exist and live. This quote comes at the end of a story of a character in a Pathfinder game. Their name is Argyle. He's 20th level, and Anti-Sisyphus states that Argyle has been made useless by the system of Pathfinder, made now only to kill bigger goblins. Before leveling up, before getting experience, upon creation of the character, Argyle was filled with potential, and it was the pushing and the rolling of this boulder up the hill that erased that potential. The meaning was forced upon him. He says, we filled him up with the goblins he killed, like they meant anything themselves.
And now, a performance of John Cage's 433. Please welcome our soloist, William Marks.
This is a piece of music. It has a score. It also goes on like this, as the title suggests, for 4 minutes and 33 seconds. This is what is considered a form of aleatoric music, in which some element of the composition is left to be determined by the performer or simply by chance. The player is translating what is ultimately a visual art into music. You can look at something like Solitude by Hans Christoph Steiner and be baffled as to how it is supposed to sound. The graphical score could be interpreted in an infinite number of ways, just at a glance. The individual shapes, the colors, the contours could all mean different things about how the piece is supposed to be played. It's similar to how on Twitter the likes of Jeremy Crawford and Christopher Perkins defend their own product, Dungeons & Dragons 5th Edition, by saying things like, the first rule of D&D is make it your own, which without context might constitute it to be anti-Sisyphean, but as the YouTuber 12tone suggests, the music of Solitude, or even 433 is not entirely random.
But that doesn't make this random. We're both trying to evoke the same shape. The score isn't just an arbitrary set of pictures. It's still a roadmap and it needs to be followed. So while your interpretation might vary from mine, it shouldn't vary within itself.
If you take a look at D&D 5e within this context now, it's quite a hefty roadmap. Sure, you could say that the first rule of D&D is to make it your own, but the other 600 rules after that say something else. And the shape those pages make are packed with inherent meaning. They're packed with those goblins that you need to fill up on. Races being coded as savage or evil. Villains that are evil, hard stop with a capital E. Players that are heroes. In the eyes of Anti-Sisyphus, the boulder is quite large at this point. And to counter this, the complete deconstruction of this stands within the mythology of Anti-Sisyphus, a zine of diminutive size, with the sole focus of stepping back from you at the table, a true aleatoric work of interpretation and improvisation. I want to end this little section about D&D with two quotes from John Cage, which I think are... well, let's just listen. If you develop an ear for sounds that are musical, it is like developing an ego. You begin to refuse sounds that are not musical, and in that way cut yourself off from a good deal of experience. And I can't understand why people are frightened of new ideas. I'm frightened of the old ones. You've crossed into another hex of this infinite desert, the rest of your party trailing just behind you. In all directions, the gray sands stretch to the horizon. There is nothing else. In all directions, the gray sands stretch to the horizon. There is nothing else. In all directions, the gray sands stretch to the horizon, and there is nothing else. In all directions, the gray sands stretch to the horizon. You hear a sudden, garbled howl, as if from a great distance. There's nothing else. Music for Airports was created by Brian Eno, an experimental musician, legendary in the field. This album is 4 tracks, 2 on each side of the tape, meant to be played continuously. Essentially, it's 4 16-minute loops. Was created by layering smaller tape loops of differing lengths, letting them play in and out of each other, sometimes solitary, sometimes accompanying one another, and occasionally playing all at once. I couldn't think of anything more Anti-Sisyphus than that.